Hello everyone, and welcome to theCUBE's live coverage of Okta Octane here in Las Vegas. We are kicking off 2 straight days of live CUBE coverage. I'm your host, Rebecca Knight, alongside my co-host, Jackie McGuire. Jackie, it is going to be fun. This is going to be a fun show.
I was so excited when I heard that you and I were hosting together because we haven't gotten to host together in a while. Identity is one of the things that I'm super focused on right now as an analyst, and Okta has a lot of fun people to interview, so.
Indeed, this is your wheelhouse. And with that, I would like to introduce our first guest of the show, Vivek Raman, VP and GM of Okta Personal. Thank you so much for coming on, Vivek. Your first time on theCUBE.
That's right, thank you so much for having me. Very excited to be here.
So you are the GM of Okta Personal. Why don't you start by giving our viewers a big picture Okta Personal and how we should think about Okta Personal within the broader identity ecosystem.
Sure, yeah. So Okta Personal was kind of started as, trying to help Okta think about where we play in the consumer identity space. And where we think consumer identity is going today is around verified identity and helping regular people prove who they are on the internet. And especially in this age of AI agents and bots and deepfakes, this is getting more and more important. And so, Okta Personal is really a product built on, or built for consumers instead of our traditional enterprise products, yeah.
So what are the most common use cases for personal identity?
Yeah, I think where we're really seeing interest and adoption is around combating fraud and verifying who a user is on the other side of the screen. So an easy example of that is, you're onboarding to an application and you want to do like an ID verification check. We can make that more seamless by using verifiable credentials or like a mobile driver's license, for example. That'll help you do it in a way that doesn't require pictures and scanning your driver's license in the camera and all that, yeah.
And on the business side, I think before we started filming, we were talking about things like know your customer laws, right?
That's right.
So I think not everybody's aware that banks are actually legally required to
That's
verify
right.
you are who you say you are,
That's
and
right.
if you're not, and they didn't do what they were supposed to, they can be held liable,
That's
right?
That's right, yeah.
I know one of the things, I actually cheated a little bit, and I went to the analyst program, so I got a little bit of a sneak peek on what we were going to be talking about today, but can you tell, let's talk about legacy identity. So in the personal space, and I think personal tech generally lags enterprise tech, right? Because individuals don't have as much to lose. So historically, how have we gone about doing this identity verification?
Yeah, so historically, digital identity verification has been something that you do only in like rare instances online. So when I go to pay my taxes, for example, with the IRS, I have to go do a face scan and like scan a physical document, passport or a driver's license. And that's kind of a one-time thing. If you're building an application that requires that, it's pretty costly. You have to involve third parties and introduces a lot of user friction. And so where we see this new technology around verifiable credentials helping with this is making that repeatable and easy and much more frictionless for users.
So you've used this phrase selective disclosure. What does that mean and how does it let people share only what's necessary without oversharing?
Sure, well I'll give you the an example. So if I want to go to the liquor store and buy a bottle of wine, which I'll probably do after this interview, I hand over my driver's license, which has my full name, my home address, my photo, all that stuff, where all they really need to know is, am I over 21 or not? And so selective disclosure with verifiable credentials lets you, the user, be in control of what data you share. So in an online transaction, they can say, all we need to know is, are you over 21, yes or no? And that's it. And they can trust the answer to that.
That's amazing. So one of the things that you wanted to talk about today is digital credentials. And I think this is a really interesting concept because I think one of the biggest things that we're dealing with right now in the AI boom is the ability for people to, in a significantly more intricate and convincing way, convince you that they are people who they are not, be it with doctored driver's licenses, I've seen that, fake passports, even deep fakes with videos now. So how do you feel that verified digital credentials help address some of that issue?
Excuse me, yeah. So the cool thing about this technology is that it's a cryptographically secure way to issue a credential to a person, have them hold it on their device, and it doesn't allow you to, because of it's got cryptographic properties, it doesn't allow you to copy it or change it. And then it's attached to a human through biometrics on your device. So it's like I have to use the Face ID or Touch ID on my device to unlock that credential. So because of that, it's got all these great properties that make it more secure than a physical document.
Can we zoom out for a second and just talk a little bit about how AI is changing the fraud game and why exactly it's made identity fraud harder to catch?
Yeah, I mean, look at deepfakes, for example. It's so easy to go and create a fake video of anybody with their voice and their likeness, and so makes it harder and harder for someone, especially in the digital space, who's, you know, you're just looking at a video or listening to a voice. It's really hard to detect a fake like that way. So, yeah.
And what types of, when we're talking about credentials, what types of credentials have been like onboarded onto this digital system?
Yeah. So the wave we're seeing, the way this is starting, is with government issued IDs first. So I think 25 or so states in the U.S. now have either are piloting or have already launched a mobile driver's license program. In Europe, there's legislation coming soon to mandate a standard citizen ID that's going to be interoperable across all EU countries. And it's already adopted in a lot of Asian countries as well. And so the cool thing about this is the underlying technology is built on a few different standards, and those standards are starting to converge today. And so that's what we're excited about. It's going to make things more interoperable in the future.
And so it's interesting that Europe is ahead of the US on this. Where would you say are various industries in terms of healthcare and government and finance, which industries are leading the way and which ones are maybe lagging from your experience?
Yeah, I think leading the way, I've seen a lot of examples in healthcare. So for example, a traveling nurse who is visiting a hospital, needs access to a piece of equipment or a certain ward. We've seen verifiable credentials used to have like a proof of professional certification on a piece of equipment, and then proof of employment. You present those two together, and now you can have access right away to the right piece of equipment that you've got. So that's one area. But I'd say the broadest adoption has been in government issued IDs today, and places where you need it just makes it more widespread when the government kind of issues the ID. It gives everybody access to it rather than a small group of people, yeah.
And how are you collaborating with the government in terms of how you work together?
Yeah, so what we're doing is we're trying to advocate for these open standards that allow interoperability between states, between countries, and between different systems. What we're doing first at Okta is verifying or building into our products the ability to verify these government IDs. So when you onboard a user, either in a workforce context or in a customer identity context, if you're an application developer, you should be able to verify these government IDs in a seamless way to verify your users.
And imagine it's also a more secure way to hold that identification verification than just keeping a photocopy of somebody's driver's license in
a file somewhere
forever and ever until a hacker finds it. So is that also part of the consideration? And it's the kind of like the data lifecycle management and the not holding on to data that you don't know you have that's sensitive?
Exactly, yeah. You can imagine there's properties of VCs or VDCs where you can allow them to expire after a certain amount of time. And then I mentioned earlier, they're protected by the biometrics on your device, so you have to do a Face ID or Touch ID or something to unlock the VC, yeah.
We talk a lot about the importance of trust and building trust between companies and customers, between the government and its citizens is a really critical component of this. How do verifiable credentials change that dynamic and make trust either easier to come by or harder to build?
Yeah, I mean, I think two things we talked about I think really helped there. One is the credential is more secure than a physical document because it's got these biometric verification properties and things like that. And also selective disclosure. I think that's a big one. So I no longer have to show all my personal data to someone who just needs to know that I'm over 21 or that I'm a resident of a certain state or whatever. So, yeah.
I always say that trust is the only currency that you have in security. So, and I think it's taken individuals a while. Again, I think consumer tech always lags enterprise tech to really understand what can happen when your credentials are out there. Mm-hmm. And I was just talking to somebody the other day about, I used to always answer the phone with like, this is Jackie, and now I don't do that anymore because I'm always worried now that if somebody's calling me and then they get my voice recorded, I'm in media. My voice is
it's already out there. Everywhere.
I know.
And the cat's out of the bag.
But for a normal person who isn't attention seeking and all over the internet, do you feel like consumers are starting to become more aware of the potential fallout of these things getting
absolutely.
Out there?
Yeah, absolutely. With every media report of fraud or identity loss or whatever, I think it's just becoming more. Consumers are becoming more and more aware of these issues.
I imagine that as we continue with data leaks, at this point, hundreds of millions to billions of people's information has been leaked on the internet.
Yeah.
And so without this kind of cryptographic signature on a digital identity, do you see that eventually this will be the way that you have to verify yourself to certify that?
I do. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'm assuming that all my personal data is out there already and easily accessible. So this is definitely a much more secure and trustworthy way to verify somebody in the future.
So but privacy laws are evolving and companies are really scrambling to keep up. How do VDCs actually help organizations stay compliant without adding more red tape?
Yeah, well, the cool thing about them is it doesn't require you to store any data. So there's no sort of like, it's a distributed architecture. So your VDC lives on your device as an end user, and you just present the proof to the company you're presenting it to. They don't need to store anything that they're not, like any extra data that they don't need, that they don't want to keep track of. So.
It's almost like a public-private key relationship, right?
That's
really interesting. So. Over the next couple years, as you're thinking about how you build out Okta's personal business and kind of where you're going, what role do you see VDCs playing in that business?
Yeah, we think that I think in the future that you're going to have a bunch of different VDCs that you hold, and that kind of will make your personal identity. So it'll be my government-issued ID, my driver's license, my passport, my proof of employment, maybe some professional certifications and things like that, and I'll choose what context and who I want to share it with. But that is kind of what I see as the makeup of my personal identity in the future.
So you see the average person's experience almost like you're boarding a plane and you just show one.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I like to kind of equate this to tap to pay with a credit card. So like 10 years ago, we used to swipe credit cards or use that machine. Like, and then we started to tap the card. And now I have my phone, my credit cards in Apple Pay. I just carry my phone around and I just tap my phone wherever I want. I don't even carry a wallet around anymore. And so it'll be very similar in our view that we think the future will be your IDs will be part of your phone in a digital wallet.
I use my actual credit card so seldom now that I left it somewhere a week ago and I was able to just pull up the Amex app and be like, all right, the only three places I actually used a physical card in the last month, and it was very easy to narrow down. So I agree, I can't wait to get rid of all of the cards in my wallet and I have like four IDs, right? I have my global entry ID, my driver's license, my passport, it just seems like overkill at this point.
But so what's holding this back? What kind of adoption challenges are you seeing?
Well, I think there's a couple things. This technology's been around for a few years now. I think there's been a lot of different standards that have been competing, and so we're kind of starting to see some convergence today, especially with Google and Samsung and Apple native wallets starting to converge on the same set of standards. So I think that's going to help adoption a lot. And governments have to get their act together. They're slow to move. And so I'm excited to see the rollout of mobile driver's licenses in the US and this legislation in Europe that's going to, I think, really accelerate adoption soon.
Okay, so we're here at Okta Octane 2025. What do you want to be able to say about Okta Personal when we're back? Next year, 2026.
I want there to be a bunch of customers, Okta customers that already have integrated verifiable credential technology into their workforce onboarding and recovery flows into their customer identity flows for customer onboarding or recovery or verifying their users. And I want, government agencies, like if there was a state or a country representative up here that could be on stage with us talking about how great it is that now you can use your digital ID in so many places, that would be awesome.
I like the vision, and I want them to just know I'm over 21 and I deserve that bottle of wine. I'm ready for it.
No, I get carded all the time.
Showing off, just humble bragging. No. Vivek, a pleasure having you on theCUBE. Thank you so much for coming.
Pleasure to be here.
I'm Rebecca Knight for Jackie McGuire. Stay tuned for more of theCUBE's live coverage of Okta Octane. You're watching theCUBE, the leader in enterprise tech news and analysis.